Hey, Village Church, so glad you are watching this or listening to this. We're so excited that you're part of this online community. And we as a church, we love Jesus. We want as many people as possible to hear about Jesus in Canada, but also around the world, which is where you are watching or listening to this. We're so glad you are. A couple big things for you. The first one is I would say, come visit our website. This is villagechurch.com. We have our teachings on there. We have ways that you can connect and understand the philosophy and the ministry methodology that we do as a church. And we just love you to be a part of that and understand that more and more. Secondly, we want you to join a community group. So go to thisisvillagechurch.com/groups. And we want to take you from just maybe watching or listening to content and actually being part of our church. Also, you can give. It costs a lot of money to be able to reach as many people as we're trying to reach with technology and staffing and so on. So we would love you to be part of that. This is villagechurch.com/give. Thank you guys so much. Hopefully you enjoy this week's teaching. From Mount Oar, they set out by the way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom, and the people became impatient on the way, and the people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there's no food, there's no water. We loathe this worthless food. Then the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, so that many people of Israel died. And the people came to Moses and said, "We've sinned, for we have sinned against the Lord and have sinned against you. Pray to the Lord that he take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said to Moses, "Make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole. And everyone who is bitten, when he sees it, shall live." So Moses made a bronze serpent and set it on a pole. And if a serpent bit anyone, he would look at the bronze serpent and live. What? What a bizarre situation, a bizarre story from the Old Testament, Numbers chapter 21. But we kind of can't, is this an overstatement, understand Jesus Christ and what he did in the world without grasping it. See, this is the backdrop to the conversation we're in right now. Here's Jesus talking to Nicodemus, maybe the most famous conversation in the Bible. And today we're going to hit probably the most famous verse in the entire Bible, the verse that people hold up at the football games and the baseball games, John 3:16. And most of our culture looks at the people holding that sign and they have no idea what that verse says. Forget about the fact that they have no idea what it means. And we're gonna unpack what it means. I'm glad you're here. I'm Pastor Mark, glad that you're part of Village Church Online. These are crazy times and we're looking to the Bible and we're looking to Jesus and we're looking to God to answer the anxieties and pressures of our time. And here we see this crazy story. There's God sending snakes to people. And it's interesting, the snakes bite the people and they die. And one thing we got to understand in our theology is that God is the author of life and death. And I know that shakes us a little bit, but sometimes we, you know, remember that song, that old song, "He gives and takes away." He gives and takes away, right? So that comes from Job, all right? And that's literally a Bible verse given to Job when he's like, why are people around me dying? And it's like, okay, I got to take good. See, in our theology, sometimes we don't pack that verse in. We leave that verse aside and we sing like, "He gives and gives some more, but he's not allowed to take things, all right? But in Job's theology, in the biblical theology, God is the author that even, that every sparrow that dies, not, no sparrow dies without it going through the Father's hand. And of course that's difficult, but there's comfort in it too, because what's the other option for you? That we live in a chaotic universe and Satan wins, and Satan is sovereign over death and life and sickness and disease, and when the snakes and the serpents come. But the Bible goes, no, God is sovereign over it. And the other options are actually worse. You have, there is no control. There is no good father over life and death. And so we see in this story, the people are always complaining. Why haven't you done this? Why haven't you done that? You got to understand that Numbers 21 story. That's the story I read my children every night when they go to bed whining and complaining. You keep whining like the Israelites, and God's going to send a little serpent after you at night to bite you. All right, no, I'm just playing, but that'd be bad parenting. But there's a piece. Now, here's the beautiful, crazy part. This is why I say all this, because in our passage in John 3, we're working through the Gospel of John verse by verse. We ended at the beginning of verse 14 last week. And now this is the rest of 14, 15, and 16. Look at what Jesus says. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness. That's the backdrop to the story. It's such a bizarre, interesting scenario. The serpents were the things that were killing them. They were the enemies. And God goes, I'm going to use that thing that's hurting you in an upside down, inverted, crazy, ironic of irony way. It's the thing you're going to have to look to save you. This is the God that's upside down, y'all. He doesn't make sense to our rationality sometimes. It would be like, so last night, I'm sitting in my bed and I hear my oldest daughter scream from her bedroom, all right? So it was like, she, you know, there were 14 monsters in her closet. I don't know. It's just like blood curdling. We jumped up from our bed. We're like, what's going on? We run into her bedroom and there's this spider. All right. It's like a wolf spider and it's crawling out from under some little sheet or something. And she's losing it. She's running out of the room. Save me, save me, save me. So I get my shoe and Aaron did. I threw my shoe to Aaron and Aaron stomped it because I don't like spiders. They're gross. So my wife goes to war with this spider, kills the spider. And then the next day I hear Sienna telling the story to her sisters. And they're like, "God, no, here's the reality." She's like, guys, this spider, it was the size of my fist. That was the quote. All right. The size, it's like Shelob. All right. In Lord of the Rings here. No, the spider, I literally saw it. It was this big. All right. She's saying it's the size of her fist. It was the size of her thumbnail. Anyway, point being, imagine I looked at that spider that she caused her so much, and then I made it a bronze version of it, and I said, now I'm going to hang this over your bed. You've got to stare at it so it can bring you life, all right? This thing that you're terrified of, this thing that's brought you destruction, this upside, and it's going to actually create life for you. This is what God does, because why does he do this kind of stuff? Do you ever wonder that? Because he doesn't want us to depend on ourselves. He wants us to be so like just in awe and upside down and at the end of ourselves that we go, I guess this is what I'll do. I guess it'll make sense. I'll just look to this thing that I never would have looked at in the history of my life, because I'm going to trust the God behind the serpent. I'm going to trust the God behind the bronze spider. I'm going to trust the God behind my weird circumstance. I'm going to trust the God behind the fact that I'm sitting in my house quarantined from the rest of the world and I just want to go back to normal and live, and I don't understand the why and the why and the what and the why, and he's going to use it for your good. That's the ultimate hope we've got and what Christianity offers the world. And so he brings in this story of the serpent, but what about it in particular? He says to Nicodemus again, who knows this story from Numbers 21 so well, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness and Israel looked to it and it saved them, so that must the Son of Man, that's of course Jesus, for those of you who are new, must be lifted up. This is the key phrase. Can I tell you something? Lifted up. We got to understand something. This becomes the center of Christianity. And if you're new to church, you got to understand, if you just read this passage, you might go, I don't know what the lifting up is. What does that mean? The Son of Man is going to be lifted up. It's kind of like when you read John, It's like watching a good movie where you kind of only understand it the second, third time through, right? My kids, I'm taking them through some great movies right now, and we're watching Inception, and we're watching Shawshank Redemption, and we're watching Sixth Sense, and we're watching all these things. And it's only the second, third time through that they go, oh, that's what that was about. It was a foreshadowing, it was a nuance, it was a metaphor, it was something that I only understand when I get to the end of the story. And when you're reading John, there's three times Jesus uses this phrase, lifted up. He uses it in chapter 12, they use it in chapter 19, when Jesus gets, of course, lifted up on the cross. That's the point. Of course, Nicodemus doesn't understand that yet, but that's the point. He gets lifted up on the cross, and it's saying, that's the thing that you've got to look to be saved, to be healed. And what you gotta understand is that if you're new to church or you're new to Christianity, we're so glad you're part of our church. One of the things that you might get confused by is you begin to think that Christianity is about all these different things, that it's about the teachings of Jesus, that it's about whether you speak in tongues, or it's about the prayer of Jabez, or it's about the end times, or it's about some kind of political ideology, or it's about leadership in the church, or it's about gender issues, or it's about identity stuff, or it's about sexuality stuff. And what you forget and what you will get lost is that the center of those things is of Christianity is not those things. Those are peripheral. The center is here, the cross. The fact that the Son of Man got lifted up on the cross, and this is the greatest moment of glory and love and judgment, and the climax of the story of the universe is in this Son of Man being lifted up on a cross. That is the center. Looking to the teachings of Jesus is not what saves you in the end. You could do everything in the Sermon on the Mount and still go to hell when you die, because the Son of Man, you didn't get your sin forgiven. You didn't get reconciled to the God of the universe through the lifting up of the Son of Man. This is the center of the center of all things. And we get distracted by the peripheral. We get distracted by the marginal things. And this is why, Village Church, if you're wondering why we talk about the cross every week, this is why, because this is the center. This informs our community group curriculum. This informs the songs that we sing. This informs our philosophy of life and ministry. This informs what we think you should do with your money life and your marriage and your work life. This informs everything. This is the center of Christianity. Nothing else is. Everything else is downstream from this. And you could literally go to churches and be there for years or months and sing songs and never understand that the center of the Christian gospel is the death and the resurrection of Jesus, the lifting up. You could go to community groups. You could listen to years of sermons and think that Christianity is about following the teachings of Jesus. It's not. It's about following the teachings of Jesus as implication of somebody saved by the work of the cross. That's why they didn't, when the early church had all kinds of options when they were going to come up with the symbol of the center of Christianity, and they could have made it a pulpit to symbolize Jesus' preaching ministry, as John Stott once said. They could have made it a towel to symbolize his servanthood. They could have made it a number of things, but they made it the cross because that's the center, the lifting up of the Son of Man. That's the point of it all. Now, over and over in the New Testament, it says this. When you get to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, here's the Apostle Paul saying, I could talk about a lot of things. Here's what he says. Verse 2, I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I decided to know nothing among you. Not like fun teaching that all starts with the letter S, not little rhymes that you're gonna, nothing among you but Jesus Christ and him crucified in particular. That's what the songs should be about. That's what the preaching should be about. That's what our life, more importantly, should be about. The crucified Jesus, not just Jesus in general, not just vague spirituality, not just believing in God, Jesus Christ and him crucified in particular. That's part of the point, that God uses this wacky, upside down, what Paul goes on in 1 Corinthians 1 to call the foolishness. And he uses this foolishness, this wackiness, to do this redemptive thing. So I was talking to one of our pastors today, our Pastor Zach, who's our online church pastor. He told me this story. He said that he was talking to someone in Seattle who had become part of Village Church in Seattle, and they said that they were in a church service. They'd walked into church. They'd gone to this church a few times, and coming to the church service, and they're sitting and standing in the sanctuary, kind of trying to find a seat. And they looked over and they saw this kind of weird guy. Like, he was sitting in the back, and he was a little kind of like, she was like, is this guy homeless? He was just kind of like squirmy and like, just not really settled. And like, she's like, I don't know if he's kind of new. I don't know if I should go talk to him. He just seems kind of out of place. I don't know what to do. And so she kind of waited, and she was singing a song, and then she just kept like thinking, man, maybe I should go talk to this guy. Like, maybe I should talk. She's 2-3 songs, and maybe I should talk to this guy. She kept looking back at this guy, like, I wonder. And then she said, okay, I was just about to go talk to him. And then the pastor got up on stage and he said, I want to introduce to you our speaker for the day. And it was this guy, and that guy was me. All right, Mark Clark, I was sent, this person thought I was a homeless person. I don't know what's going on. She's like, well, I don't know what's wrong with this guy. I got to go talk to him. Something's wrong with him. He's twitchy and twerky and something's off. And it was me. Come on. Right? And so it's like, listen, guys, you got to know something. Like, you know, I'm a little odd, man. I'm twitchy, I'm twerky, whatever. And so it's like, I don't know if twerky is the right word. Don't look it up. But I'm just like, but if what I do, week in and week out, is it all redemptive for you? If it all helps you, then that's all by the grace of God, not because of me, but in spite of me. And that's the beautiful picture of the cross. I thought about that when he told me that story. Like, it's this upside down, wacky, foolish thing that in that culture was the odd thing. That it was like, you don't want to be part of it. And it's being used to redeem the world. It's being used because God can take these things and do something. This is what Jesus is saying. He's saying, the Son of Man's going to be lifted up. And this is the thing that's going to save you. And this is the beauty of it. It's the acid test of the Christian life. Not your morality, not the church you go to, not whether you sing well, preach well, do certain spiritual things, whatever. And this is what I realized this week. When you go back to the Genesis story, what hit me this week is, what are Adam and Eve doing? They're being tempted to become like God. The serpent says to them, ironically, the serpent in the garden says, if you eat of the fruit, you will see and you will know and you will be like God. And then they do that. And in that moment, what is happening? What's happening is humankind, Adam and Eve, in that moment, they fall because they're trying to lift themselves up. And so what's the redemptive moment? See, every person watching this right now, here's the only question at the end of all things. It's that, do you want to lift yourself up and try to save yourself by lifting your own name up, lifting your own reputation up, lifting up yourself to become like God? Or will you trust in Jesus being lifted up for you? In God himself coming and lifting himself up to redeem you from the lifting up of yourself. That's the point. That's the redemptive story. The cross is the thing that reverses the sin that so easily entangles your life. This is the center of Christianity. And then it says this, he must be lifted up. And that's why we will always be about the cross. That whoever believes in him may have eternal life. I'm going to come back to whoever and believes in a second, because it's the quintessential part of the verse of John chapter 3, verse 16, which is the next verse. But the point here is, he says eternal life. It's the Greek word aionios zoe. Zoe is the Greek word for life, if you've ever met someone with that name. Aionios was eternal, everlasting. And here's the thing you gotta understand about it. It doesn't just mean a quantity of life, like you will live forever. It's a quality of that living forever life. It's either you live, that's why Jesus is gonna go on, he's gonna say in John chapter 10, I came to give life and life to the full. That's what's being offered you by Christianity, all right? Life to the full. That's what eternal life is. It's this, we try to find life to the full in everything that we do, in the person we marry, in everything we eat, in the what we dress in the what we go into for a career, in how we raise our kids. All of these are driving the question of eternal life. Because it's not about quantity, it's about quality. We all have this ever elusive pining and yearning for the good life. That's what life's about. Everything we do is about trying to find that fulfillment, to have purpose, meaning, value, joy, delight. And what Christianity says is you're never gonna find it in lifting yourself up. You've gotta find it in the one who got lifted up for you. That's the only way to get this ever elusive joy that you're constantly fighting for, that you're constantly trying for in your life at all. I remember when I was in Bible college, my best friend at the time wasn't a Christian guy, and he looked at me after 2 or 3 years of Bible college, and I'd really been working through my understanding of salvation in light of the book of Galatians, because I was in a Galatians course and just working on it tirelessly in my life. And I realized by the time I got to chapter 4 of Galatians, Paul was saying this beautiful thing. And the guy asked me, what's the most profound thing? I remember I was asleep over at his house, and he looks at me, it's like 2 a.m. and goes, what's the most profound thing you've learned being at Bible college so far? And I looked at him and I said, without even thinking, I'm like, it's that Jesus Christ is the means by which I can be truly human. And he's like, isn't it just all about going to heaven when you die? See, that's what some people have thought eternal life is. Now, eternal life is a quality of life that starts now. We got broken in the garden. We went off key. The instrument went off key, and Jesus Christ is the way to get it back on key. This is the point. We become truly human. And the problem is our pursuit of the better life, the good life, when we don't root it in the one who is lifted up for us, it only creates more pain, more tragedy for us and the people around us. We've seen it in our secular culture, in the experiment of the Western world for the last 200 years. We've tried secular answers to the question of eternal life. And what have we got? One writer says this, the 20th century has been the most barbaric in history. We think progress, baby. We think salvation is gonna happen by progress, technology, education, democracy. And what happened in the last 100 years? The 20th century has been the most barbaric, this writer says, in history. It makes the myth of progress read like a cruel joke. 160 million human beings slaughtered by their own kind in the context of war. There's been more dying of starvation in a single decade than in all of history combined. The AIDS epidemic, the widening gap between the rich and the poor, racism, the environmental crisis, the threat of nuclear holocaust, the list goes on and on and on. That's when we try to answer the question of aionios zoe, by looking to human life, human institutions, human systems, human ways of being saved, sexuality, reputation, beauty, better, more money, a better job. Fail, 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 fail. Only through the one who is lifted up for you. You ever wonder why you sin? You know why you sin? Because you're trying to answer the question of eternal life through something other than God. Here's what I mean. One writer has said, I remember reading years ago, every man who walks into a brothel or a strip joint is looking for God. What's behind that habitual lust that you can't break free of? What's behind that addiction? What's behind the shopping that is endless for you? What's behind the constant move toward trying to stimulate yourself through this pleasure or that one or that one? It's a searching for eternal life in everything but Him. That's the point. That's what sin in the end of the day is. It's basically you driving toward that kind of delight in something other than God. And so we need to find it in Him. John is gonna go on to explain eternal life in this way. Let me explain it now from a second angle. In John chapter 17, Jesus is praying and He says, this is eternal life, that you know God. So yes, it's the going after this joy and delight, but then it's a knowing of God. J.I. Packer in his book, Knowing God, says this, what were we made for? To know God. What aim should we set ourselves in life? To know God. What is the best thing in life? Bringing more joy, delight, and contentment than anything else. He says, knowing God. That's the point. Listen to Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 23, 24. Let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man boast in his might. Let not the rich man boast in his riches. Those are three things we do all the time, right? That's what social media basically is. Hey, everyone, look at me. I'm legit smart. I'm critiquing everybody else. I'm showing everybody they're so stupid, or their version of Christianity is bad, or their version of religion is bad, or their version of philosophy is bad, or their version of the COVID vaccine is bad, or their version of, I'm so wise. I'm so smart. Let not the mighty man, I'm strong, I'm powerful. Let the rich man, boast in his, look at my house, look at my life, look at my clothes, look at my cool friends. And then it says this, verse 24, but let him boast, let him who boasts, boasts in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who practices steadfast love, justice, and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, declares the Lord. Let him boast that he knows me. Do you know God? Or do you simply know about him? This becomes the question. And so this idea of Zoe, life itself, C.S. Lewis years ago pointed out there's two kinds of life. There's bios and there's Zoe. Bios is biological life. Remember the whole context of what Jesus has said. You can be born naturally of natural life, or you can get true life, Zoe life. You can get spiritual life through the power of the Spirit in the work of the cross. That's the point. So C.S. Lewis says this. That is precisely what Christianity is about. This world is a great sculptor's shop, he says. We are the statues, and there's a rumor going around the shop that some of us are someday going to come to life. That's the point. And then, of course, it says, how do you get this eternal life? He says, whoever believes in him. What does that mean? I just believe that Jesus existed? No. Like you trust in the finished work of the lifting up, the believing. Here's the crazy thing about this verse. You know how like we've been pitched a kind of Christianity where what saves you is like saying this prayer mantra one time at summer camp when you're eight and then you're locked in? I believe, of course, people who repent of sin and pray to accept Christ are, of course, saved. But that's not the emphasis of this verse. Here's what's crazy. You ready for this? 98 times in the book of John, the word believe is used as a verb. Not one time is it used as a noun. Here's what that means. Whoever is believing. Like you're like a verb, right? A verb is an action word. I'm walking, I'm talking, I'm touching, I'm singing. Those are verbs. 98 times the word believe is used as a verb. A continuous action of believing. A noun is like, this is a table. It's a table. Faith, belief, believing constantly. Every morning when your feet hit the floor, when you awake, you're believing in Jesus, the lifted up one for you for eternal life. You have this ongoing, trusting relationship with him. Now, we hit the most popular verse in the Bible. And we could spend, of course, 2 or 3 weeks on this verse. I'm going to do my best to do it in 15 minutes. For God, now remember, in the New Testament, there weren't quotation marks. And so most Bibles show this passage as read, meaning Jesus is talking. I think, and most and scholars are divided about this, I actually think Jesus has stopped talking potentially at this point. And now this is John's commentary where he's theologically kind of exegeting everything Jesus just said. Could be either or. I think that makes the most sense. Here's this for word, for, I'm doing this pivot, I'm doing this therefore thing. For God, and if those of you who are new to Christianity or just exploring or maybe coming from another religion, you might, I don't want you to like dump your own definition of the word God in here, because God to our culture is the Bette Midler God from a distance, the God, the deistic God who makes things, the you know, the old man with the beard. That's not the God we're talking about. It's like the Christian God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, the Creator, the Redeemer, the one who makes us in our image, the one who is totally sovereign, the one who is immutable, the one who does not change, the one who is perfect in every way, all powerful, all knowing, all present. This is the God of the New Testament. And what does he say about this God and his redemptive plan? He says that he so loved the world. I love this. He so loved. How many of you have been pitched a version of God where he's malevolent? He's just angry all the time. Angry, and he's waiting for you to mess up, and he's lightning bolt you like Zeus every time you sin, right? Okay, you looked at that thing on the computer and you feel like a worm now. You did this thing with your money, you lied that time, you spun that story, you cheated on your spouse, you did whatever it is, and you just feel like you're unforgivable now, and that why would God ever deal with you? You understand, Romans 5 says, that is while we were sinners, Christ died for us. That's what John 3:16 is saying. He so loved the world that he gave his only son. That the love is what motivated him. The love is what some of you just need to hear that you're loved. You don't feel loved. You didn't have parents that loved you. You did something that you're so ashamed of. You're so guilt-ridden of. You don't think anyone could ever love you again, see you again. God so loved you in the state where you were hating him that he did the work before you loved him. He didn't return. See, this is what we do. We return love to people who love us, right? I post a picture on Instagram. If you like it, I like you. If you bust my chops about it, I don't like you and I unfollow you, right? This is what we do. We respond to other people and how they, this is, God is the first mover. He loves before we loved him. And so he loves us, the sinful world. He's the one hunting us down. It's beautiful. I'll give you this image. Someone told me this story the other day. So this guy had started attending Village Church recently, and he goes to this party. I think it was like a wedding or something, like COVID special, whatever. And there was this guy. He pulls up to the little bar area and he'd been having a few and he was kind of feeling a little tipsy and he was just like a little lost in life. And the guy just got talking to him and they started chatting and the guy just kind of looked at him and he goes, "Hey, I just want to ask you a question. Like, are you spiritual?" And the guy who'd started coming to church is like, "Yeah, actually I'm a Christian and believe in Jesus." And this guy's like, "Yeah, well, you know, I don't know about any of this stuff, but I'm asking these questions." And the guy says this, he says, "I want to give you a book. And then every month or so, I want you to read a few chapters. We'll meet together. We'll have a coffee and we'll talk about whatever your questions are." And the guy goes, "Okay, fine." So he gives him The Problem of God, the book I wrote a few years ago. And that book, the introduction of that book opens with me telling the story that many of you, if you've been around Village, you know, very long, have heard, which is that I grew up in kind of an agnostic home. My dad was an ardent atheist, so much so that when my brother, whose name is Matthew, was born 4 years before me, my mom wanted to name him Matthew, but my dad was so anti-biblical that he didn't want him named Matthew. So he said, "Fine, if you're going to name him Matthew, you got to spell it with one T, not two, because I don't want it to be biblical at all." And then, of course, 4 years later, they named me Mark, so he clearly never picked up a Bible before. And so that's how I opened The Entire Problem of God. Well, this guy gets a text from this other guy within the first 2 days. He goes, "Oh my goodness, this is insane." He goes, "You have to call me." The guy calls me, he goes, "What?" He goes, "Dude, you don't understand." He's like, "My life is such that my older brother, whose name was Matthew, is Matthew. My parents spelt his name with one T because they didn't want to be biblical. And I've never heard anybody say this in my life. And now the first page of this guy's book that you give me is the same story as mine." Now listen, guys, if you don't believe in God, listen, God is hunting you down. If you're watching this right now, what are the chances of that? God is moving before you even look at him, guys. You are sitting at a waiting just for another drink, asking the questions of life, and God has a plan for you. He's moving towards you. He's going to use the circumstances of your life to save you, but you got to open your eyes to the love. Some of you are blind to the love. You're blind to the reality that he's moving. He's setting up circumstances, relationships, conversations, book readings, whatever it is to reach you. Open yourself up to him. Don't have an experience like that and then close yourself off to it. It's because he loved that he did this. He gave, not begrudgingly, but in love, he gave his only son. Now, this phrase, his only son, it's a phrase that has been debated. In the Greek, it's made up of two words, mono and genes. So mono means like one or only, as you can see here. And genes is the word like Genesis, like the starting of something. That's why in the old version, it's begotten, right? That he gave his one and only could be the thing, or his one and only uniqueness, but also this unique Genesis, the begetting son, meaning, here's what Lewis says. In Mere Christianity, he spends a chapter on begetting, because it's an old word and we don't really understand it, but it's a very important point in regard to who Jesus is. Because if you talk to a Jehovah's Witness, if you talk to a Mormon, if you talk to a Muslim, Jesus was created by God. He's a created being. But in Christianity, Jesus is never created. He always existed. But he becomes a human being at a certain point in history. So here's the distinction that C.S. Lewis says. He says, to beget is to become the father of. To create is to make. And the difference is this. When you beget something of the same kind as yourself. A man begets human babies. A beaver begets little beavers. And a bird begets eggs, which turn into little birds. But when you make something of a different kind from yourself. A bird makes a nest. A beaver builds a dam. A man makes a wireless set, or he may make something more like himself than a wireless set, say a statue. If he's a clever enough carver, he may make a statue which is very like a man indeed, but of course it's not a real man. It only looks like one. It cannot breathe or think. It's not alive. What God begets then, Lewis says, is God. Just as what man begets is man. What God creates is not God. Just as what man makes is not man. This is why men are not sons of God. In the sense that Christ is, they may be like God in certain ways, but they're not things of the same kind. They are more like statues or pictures of God. It's a very important distinction. When we're called sons of God, children of God, we're not in the same way that Jesus was. And this point about his uniqueness is very important, because it kind of cuts against a little bit of the whole, what would Jesus do philosophy, right? We wear those bracelets. What would Jesus do in this scenario? What would Jesus do in that scenario? And I get that and I understand that. I'm just saying it can trip you up, because at the end of the day, the gospel is about the fact that we're not Jesus. And the more you try to be like Jesus, sometimes it feels like a burden and a weight, because you're not actually Jesus. Jesus was Jesus for you. He is the Son of God, born into the world at a particular point in human history to save you from yourself. And when you trust in the Son of God, then you become a son of God, a small s son, though. You are not God, contrary to the New Age movement. You aren't gods. You don't get to trust in yourself. But then look at this beautiful phrase. That whoever, you know how hopeful that is? It doesn't matter who you are. I don't care what you've done. I don't care what religion you are. I don't care if you're white, black, brown, green, purple. I don't care if you're 14, 80, gay, straight, liberal, conservative. Whoever believes in him, anybody can start a relationship with Jesus. Anybody, no matter who you are and the mistakes you've made. I knew a guy who used to go into jails and read the Bible with inmates. And the beautiful thing is one day he was reading the story of Moses. And of course, the story of Moses is that Moses looks left and right and then kills the Egyptian and buries him in the ground. And the whole group, these guys were like murderers and thieves, are like, sweet, Moses is just like us. Moses was a murderer. The guy's first, second degree murderer. He looks left and right, stabs the guy, shanks him, puts him in the ground, and God uses him anyway. Whoever you are watching this right now, whoever you are, you trust in Jesus. He changes you. He saves you. He sanctifies you. He seals you for the day of redemption, no matter who you are. It doesn't matter what family you were born into. Some of you, the families you were born into keep you from believing in him. You think, well, I was born into a family of another religion. Listen, I've been to Turkey. I've seen people come out of Islam, giving themselves to Jesus in such a special and beautiful and miraculous way. But there's a cost to that. You see, in Canada, we go out in the Pacific and we baptize someone. It's a celebration. There's clapping. In some of these countries, you give your life to Jesus, you get baptized. That could be your life. You're changing families at that point. And your family, I know people who came out of strict Orthodox Hindu religion and gave themselves to Jesus. And in the conversation back with their family and their parents, someone very close to me had this experience where they looked at their family and they said, I've given my life to Jesus. And literally one of the family members threw a knife at them in the moment, because this means death to you, because the family you were born into. And you think, therefore, I can't believe in Jesus, or I shouldn't believe in Jesus. And he says, whoever, doesn't matter what you've done, doesn't matter what family you're in, doesn't matter who you are, doesn't matter where you started. Whoever believes in him, that ongoing faith and treasuring of the work of Jesus Christ on your behalf, that God poured out his wrath on Jesus for you, that Jesus, in being lifted up, died as a sacrifice of atonement for your sins and in your place so that you don't have to, and you come in behind that, that's what saves you. That's what you're called to believe in. That's what gives you eternal life, as we talked about. But there is another option. And that's how we'll end, because we often don't. They should not perish. The word perish is the Greek word apolumi. Some people have said that must mean like they go out of existence. It's a theology called annihilationism. They cease to exist. Their soul is extinguished. But that's not what apolumi means in the New Testament. Go look it up and trace down all the linguistic times it's used in the New Testament. I did, I had to, because I started to believe that maybe these people do go out of existence based on verses like this. That the opposite to eternal life was being extinguished from existence altogether and not going on. But as I studied the New Testament, I began to realize that wasn't right, because in Hebrew parallelism, they'll compare two ideas that are exact opposites. And of course, eternal life is being compared to eternal perishing. It's not that you perish for a bit and then stop perishing. Eternal life is ongoing and forever and continuous, and so is the perishing. And the Greek word apolumi is used in a way that means it's not what it was intended to be. Here's what I mean. If you go read the lost stories in Luke 15, you get a lost coin. You know what the Greek word for that lost coin is? Or the lost sheep? Apolumi. It's still in existence, that coin. It's just under the couch somewhere. It's out of currency. It's not being used the way it was designed and intended to be used for all of its flourishing. And that's the great tragedy of the history of the universe. See, this is why, as one writer's subtitle in his book said, heaven, hell, and the fate of every person who ever existed. That's what John 3:16 is about. There are only two options in the end of the fate of everyone who ever existed, including you and me: eternal life or perishing. Not the opposite of joy and pleasure and delight forevermore, which we get in the presence of God and the beauty of God and the forgiveness of God and the glory of God. It's the opposite to that, where the pictures are fire and darkness and suffering and pain, things that aren't, they're not literal fire. Those are metaphors in the Bible for the judgment of God, which is meted out on people who don't come under the sacrifice, the blood of Jesus for them forever. It's an eternal state that goes on forever and ever and ever that you wouldn't wish on your worst enemy, to the point where it is a tragedy. Even in the eyes of God, it's a tragedy. You know, in that passage in Matthew 25, the sheep and the goats passage, one of the most famous passages in the Gospel of Matthew. There's a little phrase where they talk about the sheep and the goats, and the goats go to the place of fire and torment. And then it says, prepared for the devil and his angels. And you realize in that moment that this place of perishing was never made for human beings. That wasn't the point of it. It was made for the devil and his angels, but people who choose to track down the trajectory of where they go, which is rebellion against God and deception and accusation toward the God of the universe and all things, their trajectory ends in the same place. That's the biblical story, forever and ever. And so my heart in sharing that is only the spirit of the text. Because of course, just being afraid of hell, scared of hell, doesn't make you really trust in Jesus. I went to summer camp as a kid, and they used to hold kids' legs up like this and go, if you don't say this prayer right now, you're gonna die and go to hell. And the kid would be like, I accept Christ. It's like, I don't think that sticks. There's a reason all those kids at 20 walk away from the faith, because it's not about running away from something. It's about running toward something. The glory and the beauty and the awe of God himself. That's what I want you to hold on to. The beauty of the one lifted up for you. And once your heart and your mind and your soul gets overtaken by that, it's not about running from a thing. It's about running toward the thing. It's the expulsive power of that new, better affection that keeps you. Even through, it's not that you're always soaring high. I get it. There's times of doubt. There's times of difficulty. There's times where you pray and you feel like heaven is brass. I'm not talking about you're walking on clouds every 2 seconds. You're going to struggle. You're going to have pain. You're going to have difficulty. You're going to question. You're going to have doubts. You're going to wonder whether you're a Christian in certain times. You're going to be in the depths of sin and suffering and wonder, why can't I experience this eternal life? I thought I was a Christian. Listen, you are. But there's valleys. Read the Psalms and get encouraged, right? One Psalm, David's like, God, I love you so much like a deer pants for water. So my soul longs for you. I just lick you up and oh, taste. Oh, I love you. I hold you. You're the best. And then you're like, I hate you, God. Why are you far from me? I hate everything about you. Why don't you just kill everybody? And you're like, what is wrong with this guy? And it's like, that's faith, y'all. Until we reach the place where eternal life goes, which is once we die, the eternal expression of that, the death expression of that, is heaven itself. And that's why at the end of the day, it's not wrong to answer, you know, what does the gospel do for you? Well, I go to heaven when I die. That's true. But of course, the question of John 3 is not just about what happens when you die. It's about what it means to be alive. So let me just leave that with you. Be courageous enough to find yourself in one of these two categories. And I do pray, Father, that the people who find themselves in the first, the far from you, the lost, the trajectory of perishing, that they would believe in the one lifted up, that they would put their faith and trust and treasuring in the one who went to the cross, Jesus himself, and rose again so that they might have eternal life, that they would stop lifting themselves up and they would look to the one lifted up for them. And then every morning they would wake up and as their feet hit the floor, they would look to you and look to you and look to you for the ongoing presence, for the ongoing eternal life that only you offer. Jesus, do that among us. Let us be a church. I know we're all online right now. Whatever city we're watching from, whatever country we're watching from, and there's a bunch. I got a list today, just so many different countries, so many different cities. Guys, I love you. I'm praying for you. We hear you. We see you. We want to see you discipled. Jesus, wherever people are, let them believe in you and be on mission so as many people as possible around the globe would hear and know this message and the God behind it, and they would give their life to you to experience eternal life now and forevermore. Do that among us. We trust you, Holy Spirit, to move and speak right in this moment, and that people would believe. They'd run from unbelief and toward you. In Jesus' great name we pray. Amen.